Good day, everyone. My name is Mario Deniz, and I'm a real estate agent with Preferred Real Estate Brokers in Orlando, Florida. I decided during this quarantine time to put on YouTube some of the training classes that I've developed over time for agents that are looking for some information that might be meaningful and some training that might be a little bit different than what they've heard in the past. So that they can use some of your time in quarantine to further your knowledge of the industry. This is a four-part series that I developed on my own. You're looking at the second module of that four-part series. But worry not, this is not like a movie. So if you didn't see part one, it's okay to start in part two. Eventually, it will probably be beneficial to listen to all of the modules, but I am recording this one first, even though it's the second one, because I think it's one of the most relevant ones right now. And also, I am passionate about buyers. So a little bit about myself. I've been involved in the real estate industry since 2005, and I became a full-time buyer's agent for a developing team in 2012. I did that almost exclusively for 5 years until 2017, when I went on my own and started developing my own team. Unlike the majority of agents out there, I believe buyers are the bloodline of a real estate business, not sellers. And I spend a lot of time trying to refine the ways that we work with buyers to make it more efficient and more precise. So module two is going to be about working with buyers, and we can get started. One of the things I want to tell you is I will be using my mouse cursor. You see it right here to point at things in the slides. Since I'm not obviously in a classroom setting and I can't be pointing at things with my finger. So here we go. What is the primary goal of working with a buyer? And so I'm going to leave this up here for a second and tell you that when I do this in a classroom setting and I ask this question, generally the answers that I get from agents is that the primary goal of working with a buyer might be to get a house under contract as soon as possible. It might be to get them to sign a buyer agency agreement. Generally, the goal that people think as the primary goal of working with a buyer is a transactional goal, meaning writing an offer or something along those lines. I like to kind of take it down to the basis and say that the primary goal of working with a buyer should be to make them fall in love with you. And the reason I have this approach is very simple. I've seen agents who think that the goal is to make them sign a buyer loyalty agreement on the first appointment, have that buyer kind of get spooked about someone putting a document in front of them on their first meeting, that you know, frankly, is a little intimidating. And so I don't think that's a good strategy. I don't think going to try to sell someone a home on the first appointment or in the first few appointments, I don't think that's a good strategy either. You know, people want to get to know you. People want to have a little bit of a better feel of what's out there inventory-wise before they make a decision. So if you show up and you provide value and you are empathetic about their specific situation and you make them fall in love with you, you can almost guarantee that you'll have a transaction with them. But if you become a little too salesy or too pushy, there is a good chance that you will turn them off on this process. So the primary goal when you're working with a buyer should be to make them fall in love with you. And as you're going to your buyer's appointment, just keep that in mind and try to catch yourself when you're becoming a little too salesy with them. Some of the mirage goals, meaning, you know, mirage is this optical illusion that shows up generally for people in a desert when they're hallucinating. And so mirage goals are to write an offer, those things that we talked about, to sell them a house. That's a mirage goal. Pre-qualify them. That's a mirage goal. That's probably one of the biggest mistakes agents make. When they first meet with the buyers, they want to try to pre-qualify them. And so I'm here to tell you, most people are not everyone, there's exceptions to every rule, but we have to generalize to make conversations. And so generally speaking, people are, they value their time. So, you know, people are not out there that they know they wouldn't qualify looking at homes generally. And so I don't think pre-qualifying people before showing them houses is a good strategy. I think a good strategy is to meet them, be empathetic, talk to them, and educate them a little bit on the process, and then maybe put them in contact with a lender once you've built a little rapport. I think that's a better strategy than perhaps leading with, hey, have you been pre-approved? Yes or no? No. Okay, I need you to be pre-approved before I show you a home. Because I'll be honest with you, you may do that and you think that's a great strategy, but if those folks hang up the phone and they call another agent like me, I'm going to take that client from you, because I'm going to be like, okay, let's go meet at the house. Let's set the appointment. Let's show them the house and then try to build that rapport. And they'll probably appreciate that a little bit more. We talked about the signing the buyer and broker agreement, not necessarily a good primary goal when you first meet with a buyer. I mean, if your office requires that, or if you think that has a lot of value for your business, I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying don't make it your primary goal. There's a couple of types of buyers out there. And so, you know, when I started doing this presentation, we could go on and on and on about the different types of buyers out there. But one thing that I decided to do is I decided to break it down into two categories of buyers, just to simplify things. Because if I tell you there's 10 categories of buyers, it's going to be hard to remember how to treat each one of those. But types of buyers generally can be put into two different categories. One is going to be your sphere buyers, and the other one is going to be your warm leads. And the way that I define these, because it's important that you know that, you know, I've been to a billion sales trainers, and people have different definitions for these terms. So in my view, someone, a sphere buyer is going to be someone that knows you personally, whether it's a past client, a neighbor, or your cousin. It's someone who knows you, someone whom you've interacted with on a personal level before. And then warm leads are people who do not know you personally. And so a warm lead can be anything from an online lead that comes from Zillow or Realtor.com, or it could be your neighbor that says, hey, my brother's looking for a house. I'm going to put them in touch with you so that you can work with them. So that's kind of how I classify them. And so sphere clients are going to be your past clients, your friends, your family. And your warm leads are going to be Facebook leads, Zillow, Realtor.com, business ad. Those are generally what I consider warm leads. But I know this says past clients here, disregard that part of the slide. I mean, referrals from past clients is what that should say there. And so there's a different way to treat those two types of clients. And the very important reason for it is you've already built a rapport with one set of these folks, and with these people, these warm leads, you've never built a rapport. Some of the common mistakes that agents make when they're working with buyers from their sphere: they're not professional enough. And I think that's one that whenever I'm doing this in a classroom and I ask people to raise their hand, it seems to be the most common one. And there's a psychological background to this, and it's very simple. People generally fall into roles in their life. And so let's just think about our family for a second. I'm the youngest of my brother and I'm the youngest one. And so I was always kind of like the crazy, hyperactive kid, you know? And so that's kind of the label that my family has for me. I'm the sort of outgoing, crazy kid. And so if you think about this in your own life, you'll probably see that you fit some label or some role within your family. You might be the joke guy, or you might be the sports guy, or you might be, the baking gal, or you might be the decorator, whatever the case might be. We all tend to have a label within our circle. And so the problem with those labels is when you are dealing with people in something as important as purchasing a house, you have to do things to shed that label, at least for the time being, and give them the confidence that they're just, that them working with you is not putting them at a disadvantage. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm pretty sure that my brother, if he was going to buy a house, he's going to use me 100% of the time. But I want him to be confident that he's using me because he's my brother, but also because he's confident of my abilities. And so I think one of the mistakes that agents make oftentimes is they're working with a friend or family or relative, and they're out there showing homes and they're doing it in flip-flops and shorts. Well, you know, if you're the joking guy, maybe you're continuing to fall into that category, that label that you've given yourself or that your family has given you. And so I think it's important that when you're working with people who know you personally, that you give them the same professional level service that you would give someone who just met you. I think even though their business is more on the guaranteed, it's more guaranteed because of your relationship with them, you shouldn't take it for granted. And I think you should try to earn that business, at least in the way that you carry yourself. The other problem is, when we're working with people who know us, we oftentimes are not detailed enough. We kind of rush through the process a little bit, and we won't counsel them in the same way that we counsel people that don't know us, because we make assumptions about it. You know, we make assumptions that my cousin is an engineer, and so because he's an engineer, maybe I don't need to discuss the nuances about a mortgage or the nuances about offer writing or incentives or closing costs. And so that is a good way to make people not be very confident through the process. And so one thing that I advise agents is, if you're working with someone from your sphere, the first thing that you got to do is you got to tell them, hey, you know, I'm Mario, the crazy kid, and that's how you know me. But while we're looking for homes, I want you to understand I'm Mario, the professional real estate agent, and I'm going to make sure that we are answering every question and that we're anticipating every pitfall so that you feel better about this process. And I'll promise you, people will appreciate that you do that for them. Excessive humor and jokes is another one. When you're showing homes to your relatives, I understand for you, it's something that you do every day and you're just showing them the home, they're kind of like going through the motions and you want to joke and you want to, you know, talk about what Aunt Sally said at the dinner last night, or what Uncle Joy wore to Thanksgiving last year. But don't, you know, like, sort of put a hold on that for a minute, because for the people that are looking at the home, that are looking to purchase, that's not the time that they want to talk about that stuff. They want to talk about this home. They want to learn about the home. They want you to be their eyes and ears for the things that they may not pick up on right away. So a good thing to do when you're working with your sphere is, again, to be super professional, super detailed, and not overdo the humor and jokes. And don't disregard questions. Another problem, you know, you're showing a house to your brother and your brother says, hey, Mario, you know, what do you think about this this stain here on the wall? And, you know, if that was someone that's not on your sphere, generally you would be like, excuse me, you would be like, you know what, as a matter of fact, I printed out the seller's disclosures and they're here. It looks like they had a water leak in the past, but it's already being fixed. The stain is a result of that water leak that was already fixed. But, you know, generally we can just ask the seller to paint that, for example. And so, in the flip side, you know, you don't want to be showing a home to your brother and he asks you, hey, what about the water stain? And you say, hey, don't worry about it. You know, I'll make sure that it's good. Like, you don't have to worry about that. I got it. You know, and you don't explain the situation. You don't explain the possibilities with it. And so do not have disregard for explanation just because people know you on a personal level. And a lack of empathy. You know, I've seen this time and time again, you know, people showing home to a relative, you know, and might be that relative is wealthy, you know, relatively speaking, and then being like, well, you know, don't worry about that. You got money to fix that, or you got money to change those appliances, or don't, you know how to do the flooring. So just don't worry about the flooring. Like, you know, don't have a lack of empathy. Like, just because someone might have specific ability doesn't mean that they want to go in and do work on a house. That might not be one of their goals. Just because someone is financially able, it doesn't mean that they want to fix her up. Or like, you just don't make assumptions about what they're looking for based on what you know of them. The result when people commit these mistakes is disenchantment. I can't say that word to save my life. Disenfranchisement. Those are two things that happen. What happens is in layman's terms, what happens is people feel like they're working with you by default, but they didn't really have a choice about it. And that's a really terrible feeling. I think everyone knows that time that you went to a restaurant and the waiter was just going through the motions and you're like, man, this service sucks. And you feel like you got the waiter by default, but no one's really trying hard to serve you. Well, you know, that multiply that times a million, that's the feeling your family has or your relatives or your past clients or what, or your friends, when they're working with you and you're not being professional, you're not being detailed, you're using excessive humor, you have a disregard for explanations on the questions that they have, and you have a lack of empathy on the process. Moving on to warm leads, there is also some common mistakes that agents will make when they're working with warm leads. One of those is response time. Folks, I'm going to be very honest with you. If you're engaged in the purchasing of leads online, response time, it's not that it guarantees that you'll be successful, but if you have bad response time, it will guarantee that you are not successful. So I want to nip that right on the butt right from the beginning. If you're getting any kind of warm lead, if it's a purchase lead, so it comes from Zillow, Realtor.com, or Trulia, or Homes.com, any of those, response time is necessary for you to succeed. So, and that's not open to debate. Like that, in, when you're buying lead sources, that's what's important. If the warm leads that you're getting is someone that, you know, someone's referring you, their brother, their neighbor, or whatever, it's important that you stay within the parameters of what was, of what's expected. And so if your neighbor says, hey, Mario, I told my brother about you, he's going to be looking for a house and he's going to be calling you. A couple of things that you can do right off the bat is, hey, let me have your brother's phone number so that I can text him sometimes with availability. That's the first thing. And the second thing, if your neighbor's giving you their number right off the bat for you to reach out to them, ask them, hey, did you tell them when they should be expecting my call? One of the very important things when you're working with warm leads is that whatever expectations you set, you meet them. And understand that I'm saying I'm not saying to set the highest of expectations. I'm saying whatever that expectation is, you have to meet it. You have to exceed it. You don't want to overpromise and underdeliver a warm lead because they don't know you. They haven't built rapport with you. So you got to play it safe with those expectations. So it always looks like you're going above and beyond. The other problem with warm leads oftentimes is agents are guarded with information. So this happens very often. And I think it's kind of a disease in our industry because for many, many years, what happened with real estate agents is they were sort of gatekeepers of information. And we know that's not the case anymore because people can go to some of these websites like Zillow, Realtor.com, and they'll find out a lot of information about the house. So, you know, even just 5 years ago when someone called, sometimes they were calling to ask a question about the house, like, is the master bedroom downstairs? Or how many half bathrooms are in that house? Nowadays, oftentimes that's not the case because the information is already out there. So if you try to guard information and you try to become a gatekeeper on today's world, not only do you appear silly, but you're going to turn off those buyers. And so I have a policy of providing value to my customers. And so I will give as much information as they ask for and then some. And I'm going to elaborate on that a little bit more. But information, I think it's important to show someone that you can provide value to them. So don't be guarded with information. And that goes with showings as well. You know, a lot of people call and they are like, hey, you know, I want to see 123 Main Street. And the agent then goes on to be like, Well, before we schedule that showing, have you been pre-qualified? And before we schedule that showing and they ask all these questions, no, they want to go see 123 Main Street. Let's go see 123 Main Street. If it's okay with the seller, let's go ahead, set that point and meet at the house. And then we can get the talking going when we are in person. Following poor guidance is a big problem. You know, what happens today is we're in the age of information, but it's also the age of misinformation. So be very careful. If you're in your office and you're going to classes, you're going to training seminars, you have to turn on that critical thinking part of your brain. And the reason I say you have to turn it on is because brokerages oftentimes are in the business of deactivating your ability to think critically. Because frankly, if you start thinking critically, your brokerages may have to answer a lot of questions that they don't want to answer. So when you're going to a sales training seminar, make sure someone that's talking to you is up to date on sales techniques. Make sure they are actively selling real estate and make sure they've done it in your area. I've been to sales trainings in Florida where someone that calls themselves a coach or a trainer is from, you know, Illinois, and they want to come and tell us how to sell real estate in Florida. Well, markets are very nuanced. So a lot of what these folks say, it's not relevant. Or someone who sold real estate 10 years ago, you know, trying to tell me how to work with leads when they've never in their life worked a Zillow lead or a Realtor.com lead. And so it's very, very, very important when you're going to training. First of all, more importantly, before you go to a training, make sure that, you know, you vet who the facilitator for this training course is and what the material they're teaching on is, and try to match their credentials with whatever they're teaching to make sure that they're qualified to talk about it. And once you are there, continue your critical thinking. And listen, that doesn't mean that you're going to be skeptical about everything, but take notes and double check and triple check. And if something sounds a little bit weird, just research it a little bit more. Just don't take anyone's word, even my own, as the gospel, because you know, real estate companies are, and when I say real estate companies, that goes with title and mortgage, they're all in the business of trying to get close with real estate agents because that's how they generate their revenue. And so one way to do that is to offer a lot of classes and a lot of training. And well, here's the thing. When you offer a lot of classes and a lot of training, rarely stuff going to be very substantive. Another problem warm leads with when people work with warm leads is they misunderstand personality types. And this is huge. And so we are going to talk more about personality types in the next slide. But it is very important that people understand personality types when they work with buyers, if they're interested in doing so efficiently and with precision. Another problem is becoming too salesy. I know we sell houses for a living. That's how we get a paycheck. But here's the thing. Every industry out there is in the business of sales. Anytime you're exchanging goods for money, you're selling something. The reason, you know, there's probably five dentists in your town that are sending you postcards is because they're competing with each other, trying to sell you their services. And so I think real estate agents sometimes are misunderstood as being the salespeople of houses. Well, I don't think that's the case. I think when people fall in love with a house, the worst real estate agent in the world will not be able to keep those people from buying that house. And so with that said, become a salesperson, but of your services, not of the houses that you are showing. Make people fall in love with you. Again, we're going to go back to that theme, because if they buy into what you provide for them, the value that you give them and the service that you give them, then they will absolutely continue working with you. So becoming too salesy, being in a house and trying to handle every objection that they have about a house, perhaps not the best way to go about it, because then people feel like you don't have their best interest at heart. They feel like you're just trying to sell them something fast. You don't want to fall into that category. The first step for a successful buyer interaction, become psychic. I mean, when I'm doing this in a classroom, I generally, you know, have a little fun with it. But really, the best way is to become a psychic. And there's a way to do that. And it's by understanding the personality types. This is where we're going to talk about that a little bit. There is, you know, most people in real estate are familiar with this. This is the DISC personalities. And so there is different personality breakdowns out there. I think the DISC is the best one, because it can be understood. So in order for something to be effective, it needs to be easily understood. And B, because it relates very well to real estate. You know, it's not too convoluted. And so how do you become a psychic when you're working with buyers? Well, the way you become a psychic when you're working with buyers is by being able to understand the four personality types that are out there, the traits about those personality types, and then being able to speak with people in a language and a manner that makes sense to them. And so when you're working with a buyer, and I'm going to tell you how this can become a pitfall oftentimes, let's talk about the D personality type, for example. D personality types are very direct, they're results oriented, they're firm, strong-willed, and forceful. So this is your people that don't use very many words. This is your people that don't do small talk. Oftentimes this is described as the CEO type, kind of a little bit of a jerk on first encounter, but that doesn't mean they're messing around. If they're looking at houses, it's because they're going to buy a house. Well, what happens when you can determine that your buyer is a D personality type, then you can talk to them in terms that are best for communicating with people that are of a D personality type. So for example, let's use a for instance. I bring a buyer folder to every buyer meeting that I have. And if I'm working with a D personality type, I'm not going to sit there and explain a buyer folder for 30 minutes because they don't care about that. They're more to the point sort of folks. So when I'm showing them the house, I'm not going to be going like, I'm not going to go into every little detail of the house. I'm going to kind of let them take charge of where they want to go in the house. I'm going to answer questions that they have. And most importantly, with D personality types, I'm not going to make up answers on the fly. I'm not going to try to fluff them. I'm just going to give them what it is that they're looking for and they're asking for. And also, I'm not going to get offended when they're very direct with me, because that's another thing that happens often. One of the things is most real estate agents fall into the I personality types. And sometimes when an I encounters a D, the I gets their feelings hurt. And so we don't, when you know you're working with a D, you just have to understand that their communication style is a little bit different. And so I'm not going to go into every one of these personality types in detail, but this is what I'm going to tell you. Tony Robbins on his website has a this profile test that you can take for free, and you can learn about your own personality type, and then it'll give you a little bit more of a rounded concepts on each one of these personality types. That way you have an opportunity to start reading there by understanding yourself, and then you can research it a little bit more. And the more proficient you become at understanding the way people communicate, the better that you will become at becoming a psychic. And so this is huge, huge, huge when you are working with buyers, because, you know, the biggest complaint that people have of working with buyers, and I mean real estate agents, is that it takes too long. You know, buyers are looking at too many houses, the process is too long, blah, 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 blah. Well, you can shorten that process if you understand the way people communicate and you can mirror them properly. So this is your secret sauce to becoming a psychic. Step 2 for successful buyer interactions, provide value. And so I talked about the buyer folder that I bring to my showings. Let me go in a little bit more detail with that. Years ago, what constituted a buyer's folder was literally just a folder with some MLS synopsis in them, and you would bring that to a showing. And that would generally set you apart from other agents because other agents were not doing that. And then We evolved to partner with mortgage companies to add to that buyer folder some standard mortgage information to provide additional value. And so then everybody started doing that. So you're like, okay, how do I provide additional value? And well, I'm going to tell you what I do with my buyer folders when I'm going to meet with a buyer. My buyer folder contains a small pamphlet that I made. It's sort of like a magazine, and it has vendor information. So anything from handymans to home inspectors in there. So resources that are meaningful and that they will likely be using during this process. I include mortgage information. I include insurance information in there. I include what sort of like some of the fees and charges and stuff. And I explain that in there as well. And I have 4 pages of frequently asked questions for buyers, for sellers, and if you're looking to buy new construction. So trying to answer some of those questions preemptively. And so it's a tangible, you know, thing. It has some weight to it. It's nicely printed. So it provides people with a ton of value because it's important information that they need through this process. The other thing that we do is if I'm showing a specific house, a couple of things that I'll do right off the bat is I'll print the tax records. I think it's important to print the tax records of the property because a lot of people, for some reason, are interested in knowing when did the buyers buy the house and how much they bought it for. And so if they're going to ask me that question, I want to be prepared to answer it in the spot. Also, you know, we know there is some guidelines with financing. If a house was, it's a flip, there's a 90-day window that you got to be sort of conscientious about. So that bringing that tax records allow me to speak about that in the case that this is a flip and it falls into one of those categories. The other thing that I'll do is I'll go to the local county building department website and I'll look up any building permits that have been pulled on that address. That way, if they did a pool, if they did a screen enclosure, if they did a fence, I can look that up and I can show up and be like, hey, they bought this house in 2006 and then they built a pool in 2010 and they put the fence in 2012. And so people start gaining a little more confidence on that specific property because you're answering questions that they didn't know they had, but when you answer them, they are like, oh man, that's great. It's good to know. So that's what I include on my buyer folder. That's how I provide tangible value when I go meet with a buyer. And so back to providing value, obviously show the home. We talked about this. You don't want to stall showing the home to get someone pre-qualified. When I bring my buyer folder with all this information inside of it, I'm becoming an educator and I'm providing information that they didn't know before they met me. And the research part is what I was talking about the going onto the building department sites and figuring out details about the home that are not readily available. Like you can't go on Zillow and figure out when they pulled permits for the pool on the house. But you can do that on your building department site. And that's one way you can provide value to people. Ask open-ended questions. I am admittedly terrible at this because I am a high D personality type. So I'm short with my words, but it's important to ask open-ended questions when you're working with buyers. And it's something that I continue to work on and try to get better at. You know, don't just ask someone like, do you guys currently live in the area? Because that's a yes or no question. But something like what brings you to the area, then that's an open-ended question that allows you to learn more about them and, you know, further develop that rapport that you're trying to build with them. Listening is so important. Listen, agents, I know we like to talk, but listening is paramount. So what you want to do when you're meeting with buyers is you want to ask those open-ended questions, listen and take notes. So people say sometimes, what do you mean by take notes? I mean, you want to have a notepad or something along the lines when people are talking to you, if you're doing a buyer consultation and they're telling you their needs analysis, you want to take notes because here's the thing. Listening is a very strange thing, right? We all enjoy it. We all love to be listened to, but we don't really know when it's happening. But we have a very good idea of when it's not happening. And let me give you an example. If you're in a restaurant with 6 of your friends and the waitress comes and says, hey, can I take your orders? And you start spouting your order and your friends start spouting your order and that waitress is not taking notes. When that waitress walks away from the table, almost unanimously, everyone will be like, ha, I bet you $1 that she's not going to get that order right. Because even though she was there and you were having a conversation, you don't believe that she was either listening or had the ability to recall all of the information that was just given to her. Likewise, when you're talking with a buyer, it is very important that you take notes when you're doing things like needs analysis so that your client knows without a shadow of a doubt that you will not forget and that you are paying attention to them. And another thing that's important is you set the next appointment. So you show the first house to them. They didn't love that house. When I say set the next appointment is you create an expectation that you guys will meet again. And so sometimes if there's other house on the docket that we are definitely going to see, that's the next appointment. But let's say there's nothing like that on the docket. They just wanted to see one house. We saw it. We finished. We're done. How do you set the next appointment? Well, you don't necessarily have to set the next appointment. You just ask someone like, hey, listen, if other homes come on the market over the next day or so, what's the best time for you guys to look at homes? What's your availability look like? You write down their availability, and then it's your job to use that availability for your advantage. Because once they give you the availability, two things happen. Now you know when you can meet them again, but now they also know they told you that they were available. So they'll likely won't schedule things during that time through the process of looking for a home, because they'll be like, you know what? We told Mario that we'll be available Tuesday between 2 and 4. So, you know, don't go to the gym at that time just in case a house pops up. So it creates that expectation. All right. This is perhaps one of the most important things that we're going to discuss today, and is it's a graph that I've created that talks about the mood of the client versus the transaction time. And you'll see that on this graph here. And so let me take this back a little bit. I strive to avoid cancellations. And, you know, in my quest to try to get a perfect record of no cancellations, I developed this graph. And this graph just... it's a way for people to understand, or agents to understand, when people's mood is high, and by high I mean happy and excited, and when people's mood is low. If you understand when these things are taking place, you'll be able to work with them in such a manner to where you diminish these peaks and eliminate these valleys, and you can make that line be a little bit more steady across the middle. Let me put this into practice. When people are in a good mood, that's generally when agents like to give good news. And what do I mean by that? Well, someone sees a home that they fell in love with, and agents will tell them that the seller's motivated and they are open to close, you know, anytime. They'll give them all the good news that they possibly can that will seal the deal to write that off. And then what happens is every single buyer on the planet goes through moods. And so they'll get to a low mood, which generally happens around inspection time, the first time at least. And that's when they receive bad news in the way of an inspection report. And so if you operate this way, which is the way I, in my experience, most agents do, you give good news when people are happy and bad, and people receive bad news when they're having a little bit of buyer remorse, this results in a ton of cancellations. And so we don't want to do that. So what we need to do is provide bad news when people are on a high, so that we can taper their expectations a little bit. That's kind of the goal. And we give them, or we make sure that they're receiving good news on their low moments. That way they continue to be engaged and excited about this transaction. And so let me put this in more practical terms. A lot of agents, they'll walk into a house sometimes and they're showing the home and they can see that the buyers fell in love with the house, and they look that there's a, you know, there might be a wall that has a little bit of a water stain on it. And the agent's like, oh my God, in their mind, they're thinking if they see this water stain, they're not going to write an offer on this house. And so they stand in front of it and they just kind of like, well, it'll come up during the inspection. So, you know, I don't need to bring it up now. Well, that's not how I operate. If I walk into a house and I sense that folks have fallen in love with it, I become hyper vigilant of everything in that house that I think may come up during inspections because I want to bring it up right now. Hey, that light's not working. Hey, that light switch plate's broken. Hey, look at the little water stain here. We're going to have to get that addressed. The reason you do that is when people are excited about purchasing a home and you take this approach, they'll overcome these issues very easily in this spot. They'll be like, oh, well, a plate switch is easy to repair. That's not a problem. And that little stain on the wall, you know what? It looks like they had a candle there or something that might have fallen in or whatever. You know, people will at that time be like, okay, I'm glad there's these issues. Like, yeah, that's fine. But we love the house. We want to write an offer on it. And so now what happens when they get to the inspection is they are starting to feel a little bit of buyer remorse because it happens to most buyers. They write the offer, it gets accepted, they earn that high. They're like, oh man, we got this. And then comes the inspection and they're like, oh my God, here comes the inspection. Something's probably going to pop up. I knew it was too good to be true. Something's going to fall apart. Something's going to come up. And so they start talking themselves out of the decision that they've already made. Well, if they get to the inspection and they learn a bunch of bad things, which is what would happen in this case, if they learn a bunch of bad things about the house, then that's when a cancellation happens. But if they get to an inspection, in my previous example, an inspector says, you know what, the home looks great. There's a broken plate switch. There's a little water stain there, but I actually think it's somebody that tipped a cup over that table. And you know, and they learn it, they don't learn about anything new or really meaningful, but they are just reassured that what they knew originally is still the things that we know now. Then they are like, whew, oh, we made it. The house is good indeed. And so I've come up with this curve that follows the entire life of a transaction from beginning to end. And this is something that I use and I teach the agents that choose to believe in this method. So this curve is going to show people's mood and it'll allow you to see where you should be giving good and bad news. So when people find a home, that's a high for them. Obviously, they're super excited about it. The next low becomes the inspection. We already talked about, you know, how to handle that so that, you know, you taper the expectations a little bit here and then the inspection, you know, hopefully we don't go so far down on it. Then when we overcome the inspection or we're through with it, that's another high. It's a moment of reassurance. This is a very good time to talk to your customers about the next step, which would be the appraisal if they're doing financing. And listen, hopefully before you wrote an offer, you did comps on the house and you know about it, but this is a very good time for you to talk about the appraisal and be like, hey, great, we're done with inspections. That's awesome. I know you guys are excited. Next up is going to be the appraisal. Listen, an appraisal is an opinion report from a certified appraiser. I'm not sure that, I'm pretty sure I have 90% confidence that there's going to be no issues with the value, but still a human doing that report. So just know that whatever pops up, it's not definitive. We'll work through it when the time comes. And that way, when we get to that appraisal, if that appraisal is low, this is not breaking news. It's not like, wait a second, I thought the inspection is the only thing that can kill a deal. What do you mean the appraisal is low? What does that mean? And so we haven't talked about it. And so by tapering their excitement here, by giving them some of the possibilities with an appraisal, when we get here, if the appraisal is bad, they're not going to go so deep on depression or sort of like in this bad, on bad mood, because I've already explained to them some of the possibilities. And when people are more educated, they're more confident and their mood swings are not as big. And so that's one way to taper that, to make that low move up, is to tell them what the possibilities are of what can happen with a bad appraisal. And so after the appraisal, you overcome the appraisal, you get that clear to close or the financing approval. That's a high. People think they're done. High fives everywhere. Put the champagne on ice. Pop the cork. We are done. Well, not so fast, because there's still another step that can and will kill a deal if the right expectations are not set. And what is that step? Folks, it is the walkthrough. It's probably the least talked about part of the process of real estate, because I think agents also get on a high when they get that clear to close. Otherwise, they wouldn't be posting it on Facebook every time they get one. When you get the clear to close, it's important that people are excited and you tell them, congratulations, the hardest and most boring part of this process is behind you. However, let me tell you what happens going forward. What happens going forward is we're going to go through a walkthrough. And the walkthrough is a way for us to ascertain that the property is still in the same condition that it was when we originally saw it, when we saw it last. Understand that oftentimes buyers are super awesome and they leave places spotless. Sometimes they just give it a broom sweep. Sometimes it looks worse than that. And so you want to tell them that. And most importantly, I think, as an agent, is if a property was occupied through this entire process, you do not want to show up to the walkthrough with the buyers for the first time and open that door for the first time with the buyers next to you. My advice to my agents is when a home has been lived in, make sure that walkthrough time is not first thing in the morning. I'd like to make it 10 or 10:30 in the morning. That way you as an agent can go at 9 o'clock in the morning and check it out and see if there's any fires that need to be put out. People should be excited at their walkthrough. If they walk into their walkthrough and there's tumbleweeds of dog hair on the house that they're about to move into, they are not going to be excited. So it's your responsibility as an agent to show up there before they do, see what may be what's behind those doors so that you can taper their mood before they show up to it. So I'll give you an example. I've shown up to a house that was tumbleweeds of dog hair. They didn't even do a broom sweep. It was just dirty. They moved everything out and everything was dirty. So what I did is I told the clients, you're going to show up to the house and it's still not 100%, but worry not. I've called my cleaners that will come and do a deep clean on the house. So by the time we sign the documents and you get back here, it'll be spotless. And so if you say that before they show up to the walkthrough, they're expecting to show up to a pigsty. So it's probably not going to be as bad as you painted it or as they painted it on their head. And then they're going to be able to overcome that and be less kind of turned off by it and still be excited, which they should be on this process. The next high is the closing, and that's when you can let it fly and high fives everywhere. And you have effectively completed the transaction. But if you see this mood curve that I've drawn here, you understand how this can be problematic and how transactions often result in cancellation during these three bottom points. Those are the things that kill transactions more often than not. So if we can make those three go up a little bit, chances are, you know, we want these three things right here. We don't want them to be here. We want them to be a little farther up. Then what happens is you have more successful transactions. When you're writing an offer, don't wait for the title company to submit a list in the state of Florida. I don't know about other states, but in the state of Florida, the title company information in a contract is something that can be filled in after people have signed the contract, and you don't have to get re-initials for it. So don't wait for someone to give you what the title company information is to submit an offer. You can fill that out after the fact, and time is of the essence. Under promise and over deliver when you're sending an offer is, listen, a listing agent may tell you that they are going to respond to your offer in 2 hours, but you and I both know that's rarely the case. So generally, even if the listing agent tells me that we can expect a quick answer within an hour or two, I'll tell the buyers we are going to get an offer, a response within 24 hours. And what does that do? Well, the buyers can go about the next 24 hours of their life with a little more at ease because they're not expecting that text message or the phone call from me. And the next thing that it does is when I do get a response before those 24 hours, maybe in 6 hours, and I call them with a response, they're going to be excited to hear from me because they're hearing from me before they expected to. And that's one way to underpromise and overdeliver. It's important to talk to the listing agent. Listen, I think it's a good idea to ask things to the listing agent like, in a perfect world, when would your seller like to close on this house in order for you to tailor your offer as much as possible to the seller's needs? However, because a lot of listing agents are very unresponsive, I don't think that that's a strategy that we can do 100% of the time. Think outside the box when you are writing offers, especially if you are multiple competing situations. You know, don't be rigid. If you're rigid, likely you're going to lose some offers that you wouldn't otherwise. I'm not saying give away your commission to everyone. I'm not saying do rebates all the time. I'm not saying any of that. I'm just saying think outside the box, because if you think the price is the only thing that you have in your hands to negotiate an offer, you are not thinking outside the box enough. It's very important that you read and understand the contract, especially in the days of electronic signatures. And the reason I think that's super important is because when you send someone a contract for electronic signatures and they're signing it in an hour and they call you and you happen to be in your car when they call you and they say, hey, Mario, here in page 7 of the contract, what does this say in this paragraph? If you're not familiar with the contract, you're going to fumble through that conversation and look like you don't know what you're talking about. But if you know your contract, you can come out on top and look like a rock star. Don't handwrite contracts, please, 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 unless, I mean, we're in a pandemic right now. So if we were in a situation like power is gone, perhaps that's a good time to handwrite a contract, but otherwise avoid it. Don't type anything on the additional terms that hasn't been vetted by an attorney. We are not licensed to write legal terms. So you can get yourself in a heap of trouble when you start writing addendums and you don't write them with the proper legal terminology, and you open the door for someone to have damages through the process. So you'll say, well, every agent writes things on contracts. Yes, they do. And that's because 99% of the time things go well. So this becomes a moot point. But if it ends up in a court of law, the first question that you're going to be asked is, are you a licensed attorney? And when you say no, and they ask you, well, why did you think you were equipped to advise someone legally and write a legal document? That's when you're going to have some troubles answering that question. One thing that I do when I send an offer is I CC my lender on that offer, and I make my lender available to the listing agent for any questions. This provides extra security to that listing agent that the pre-approval or prequel letter that you're using to submit the offer was not something that came on someone's mailbox or someone got out of an online lender that is faceless. When you CC your lender, you put a face to who's going to be handling this financing. And generally, the way I work with my lender knows to reply to that email and be like, hey, yes, I've worked with Mr. and Mrs. Smith. They have perfect credit. We've gathered all their documents. And as long as we get an appraisal that's satisfactory, we're good to close on this deal. Oftentimes, that is the difference between your offer being accepted or a competing offer being accepted. And this is the part of the presentation where I ask people if they have any questions. However, since I can't see you guys, I will say if you have any questions for me, please look me up. My name is Mario Deniz, D-E-N-I-Z. You can find me on Facebook. You can find me on Instagram. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have. If you like this video and you want to hear also some casual videos of conversations with other real estate professionals, mortgage brokers, real estate attorneys, I have a podcast that's called Keeping It Real Estate. And so you can look it up in iTunes or YouTube. And it's casual, long form, unedited conversations with real estate professionals. Thank you, everybody, for watching this. Have yourselves a wonderful day and stay safe out there.